Hi there, this is Richard Walker from Lucidate. Welcome to this fourth video on Transformers and GPT-3. The Transformer architecture was introduced in a 2017 paper by Google researchers. Attention is all you need. The key innovation of the Transformer was the introduction of self-attention, a mechanism that allows the model to selectively choose which parts of the input to pay attention to, rather than using the entire input equally. In this video, we will talk about why we need attention and what design choices have been made by Transformers to solve the attention problem. In the next video, we'll delve more into the implementation of attention and see how Transformers accomplish this. Before the Transformer, the standard architecture for NLP tasks was the Recurrent Neural Network, or RNN. RNNs have the ability to maintain internal state, allowing them to remember information from previous inputs. But RNNs do have a few drawbacks. As discussed in the prior video, they're difficult to parallelize. Furthermore, they tend to suffer from the vanishing and exploding gradients problem, which makes it difficult to train models with very long input sequences. Please see the video Position and Positional Embeddings if you're unfamiliar with RNNs or either of these drawbacks. The Transformer addresses these limitations by using something called self-attention in place of recurrence. Self-attention allows the model to weigh the importance of different parts of the input without having to maintain an internal state. This makes the model much easier to parallelize and eliminates the vanishing and exploding gradient problem. Look at these two sentences. They differ by just one word and have very similar meanings. To whom does the pronoun she belong to in each sentence? In the first sentence, we would say it's Alice. In the second sentence, we would say that it's Barbara. Pause the video, if you like, to externalize why you know that this is the case. Well, in the first sentence, we have the word younger, which makes she attend to Alice. In the second sentence, we have the word older, which causes the she in this sentence to attend to Barbara. This attention itself is brought about by the phrase more experienced being attended to by the phrase even though. Now consider these two sentences with very similar wording but very different in meaning. This time, focus on the word it. We effortlessly associate the it in the first sentence with the noun swap, while in the second sentence we associate it with AI. The first sentence is all about the swap being an effective hedge. The second sentence is all about the AI being clever. This is something that we humans are able to do effortlessly and instinctively. Now, of course, we've all been taught English and spent a whole bunch of time reading books, articles, websites, and newspapers. But you can see to have any chance at all at developing an effective language model, the model has to be able to understand all these nuanced and complex relationships. The semantics of each word and the order of the words in the sentence will only get us so far. We need to imbue our AI with these capabilities of focusing on the specific parts of a sentence that matter, as well as linking together the specific words that relate to one another. For one sentence, we have to link it with swap, and in the other sentence, we have to link it with AI. And we have to do this solely with numbers. All our AI understands are scalars, vectors, matrices, and tensors. Now, fortunately for us, modern computer systems are extremely efficient at mathematical operations on tensors and can deal effortlessly with far larger structures and with many more dimensions than are spinning on your screen. So, let's spend the rest of this video describing what design the developers of Transformers came up with, and in the next video, we'll take a deeper look at how this design works. The solution was to come up with three matrices that operate on our word embeddings. Recall from the previous two videos that these embeddings contain a semantic representation of each word. If you recall, this semantic representation was learned based on the frequency and occurrence of other words around a specific word. It also contains positional information. This positional information was not learned, but rather calculated using periodic sine and cosine waves. The three matrices are called Q for query, K for key, and V for value. Like the semantic embeddings, the weights in these matrices are learned. That is to say, during the training phase of a transformer, such as GPT-3 or ChatGPT, the network is shown a vast amount of text. If you ask ChatGPT just how much training information, it will explain that hundreds of billions to over a trillion training examples have been provided, with a total of 45 terabytes of text. We have only ChatGPT's word for this, as the information is not publicly disclosed, but ChatGPT asserts that it is not given to overstatement or hyperbole. The method that GPT-3 uses for updating the weights is backpropagation. Lucidate has a whole series of videos given over to backpropagation, and there is a link in the description. But in summary, backpropagation is an algorithm for training neural networks used to update its internal weights to minimize a loss. Firstly, the network makes a prediction on a batch of input data. Then the loss is calculated between the predicted and actual output. Thirdly, the gradients of the loss with respect to the weights are calculated using the chain rule of differentiation. Fourthly, the gradients are used to update the weights. And finally, this process is repeated until convergence. Backpropagation helps neural networks like transformers to learn by allowing them to iteratively adjust their weights to reduce the error in their predictions, improving accuracy over time. So, what are these mysterious query, key, and value matrices whose weights are calculated while the network is being trained? And what role do they perform? Remember that these matrices will operate on our positional word embeddings from our input sequence. The query matrix can be thought of as the particular word for which we are calculating attention. And the key matrix can be interpreted as the word to which we are paying attention. The eigenvalues and eigenvectors of these matrices typically tend to be quite similar. The product of these two matrices gives us our attention score. We want high scores when the words need to pay attention to one another, and low scores when the words are unrelated in a sentence. The value matrix then rates the relevance of the pairs of words that make up each attention score to the correct word that the network is shown during training. Now, look, that's a lot to take in. Let's back up and use an analogy for what's going on in the attention block. Then we'll take a look at a schematic for how these Q, K, and V matrices work together before finally looking at the equations at the heart of the transformer to complete our understanding of the design. First thing, an analogy. Our transformer is attempting to predict the next word in a sequence. This might be because it's translating from one language to another, it might be summarizing a lengthy piece of text, or it might be creating the text of an entire article simply from a title. But in all cases, its singular goal is to create the best possible word or series of words in an output sequence. The attention mechanism that helps solve this is complex, and the linguistic concepts are abstract. To understand this mechanism better, let's imagine that you're a detective trying to solve a case. You have a lot of evidence, notes, and clues to go through. To solve the case, you need to pay attention to certain pieces of evidence and ignore others. This is exactly what the attention mechanism does in a transformer. It helps the transformer to focus on the important parts of the text and ignore the rest. The query, Q matrix, is like the list of questions you have in your head when you're trying to solve a case. It's the part of the program that's trying to understand the text. Just like how you have a list of questions to help you understand the case, the Q matrix helps the program understand the text. The key, K matrix, is like the evidence you have. It's all the information that you have to go through to solve the case. You want to pay attention to the evidence that's most relevant to the questions that you have. In the same way, the product of the Q and the K matrix gives us our attention score. The value, V matrix, is the relevance of this evidence to solve the case. Two words might attend to each other very strongly, but as a singular and non-exhaustive example, they might be an irrelevant pronoun and a noun that doesn't help us in determining the next predicted word in the sequence. So we have an analogy using questions, evidence, and relevance for queries, keys, and values. And that analogy, I hope, is helpful. But how do the matrices work together? In this schematic, we can see that we first multiply the Q and K matrices together, then we scale them somehow. We pass them through a mask, and we'll discuss this mask in detail in the next video. We then normalize the results, and finally multiply that result by the V matrix. We can formally write this down with the following equation. So we first multiply the query matrix with the transpose of the key matrix, and this gives us an unscaled attention score. We scale this by dividing by the square root of the dimensionality of the key matrix. This can be any number. A standard is 64, which will mean dividing by 8. We then further scale using a softmax function that ensures that the weights assigned to all the attention scores will sum to 1. Finally, we multiply these scaled and normalized attention scores by our value matrix. So to summarize, we use transformer models like ChatGPT and GPT-3 to perform language processing. This might be translation from French to German, translation from English to a computer program written in Python. Alternatively, it might be summarizing a body of text or generating a whole article based just on a title. In all cases, this involves predicting the next word in a sequence. Transformers use attention to dynamically weight the contribution of different input sequence elements in the computation of the output sequence. This allows the model to focus on the most relevant information at each step and better handle input sequences of varying lengths, making it well suited for translation, summarization, and creative tasks just outlined. The attention mechanism is captured using three huge and crazily abstract matrices. The values in these matrices are obtained using a technique called backpropagation over a huge amount, perhaps hundreds of billions of training examples. This attention mechanism, along with the semantic and positional encodings described in the previous videos, are what enable transformer language models to deliver their impressive performance. This is Richard Walker from Lucidate. Please join me in the next video where we will take a deeper dive into the transformer architecture to look at examples of training and inference of transformer language models.